What a delight for me to be with you all this year. First of all, to enjoy seeing many of you again after several years. And it's good to see those continuing on. It's also wonderful to be at a place where the Word of God is being taught, I believe, with power and might. That's what we need today. And I think it's particularly fun to enjoyable to be at a conference where there's good agreement among those that are ministering God's Word. That doesn't always happen. Sometimes people try to invite what's called a balanced agenda, and it's a disaster. It's uncomfortable. Every time you open your mouth, you realize you're picking a fight with what someone else has said. And so you probably realize that at this point that really, as speakers, we're pretty good friends. Doesn't mean that we don't have a difference here or there. Some of us like food. Some of us like a lot of food. Some of us don't eat at all. Some of us like to sleep. Some of us don't like to sleep. I drink Diet Coke. John drinks water. But that's okay. We can put up with those differences when we're united in the Lord. Yes. I got to move the mic. Oh, yeah, that makes a difference, doesn't it? Probably loud. That's going to be hard to sleep. Well, we come to our last session, my last session, and I want to talk about the coming of the Lord, and I put in there the soon coming of the Lord. I really believe that the early Christians, the fervor of the early church was the fact that they looked for Jesus to come right away. Matter of fact, the Apostle Paul, think about him. He talked about the coming of the Lord. And I want us to begin by reading that passage because I want you to see if the Apostle Paul was looking for the Lord to come in his lifetime. You see, from time to time, if you leave this conference, you might even get accused of saying, well, you're kind of a fanatic. You're looking for Jesus to come all the time. And you know something? They're right. You see, I think the Lord might come today. I'm not going to make any promise about tomorrow because Matthew said an evil servant has said in his heart, my Lord delays his coming one more day. So if you're a Sunday person, then, you know, that's not a good sign. And so someone said, yeah, but isn't that dangerous? Matter of fact, you know what? I've even had people say, I can think of the place I'm not going to mention. They said, we understand that you set a date for when the Lord's going to come. I said, well, you ought to go back and listen to the tapes or look at the DVD because I didn't. And so they did. And the guy called back and said, well, you said that the Lord may come today. I said, yeah, I did. I still believe that. He said, yeah, but you were wrong. I said, yeah, but you know what? When he said, I'm going to be exactly right. I think we ought to live in the anticipation that every day Jesus might come. And so listen to the Apostle Paul. Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them who are asleep. In other words, those that have died. That you sorrow not, even as others who have no hope. You see, Titus says this, that we have one hope, even the blessed appearing of Jesus Christ. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, do we? That's the gospel, isn't it? Even so, them also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not precede them who are asleep. Paul included himself among those that would be alive when the Lord came. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. So here's the Apostle Paul. Then we who are alive. Paul thought he would be alive when Jesus came back. Was he wrong? The answer is absolutely not. He lived his whole life anticipating that Jesus could come at any moment. What a great way to live. Do you understand the hope that gives you for every day? You can never have a bad day if you think, the Lord's coming today. The Lord may be here today. Every day is good. And so I really believe that we've lost some of that anticipation for the Lord's coming. Now go back with me to 2 Peter. Here's why we've lost that. Second Peter, chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lust. Have you ever met a scoffer? I mean, has anyone scoffed at you for believing what you do? I'm not talking about people that are unsaved. I'm talking about people in the church. I mean, it's unbelievable that there would be people who would oppose the blessed hope. It's hard to believe that there would be people that don't want the whole idea of Christ coming back for the church to be true. I mean, it's just hard to believe that because it's such joy to the early church. And so it says that the scoffers are going to come, and look at this, they come when? In the last days, saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. Wow. He has a promise, doesn't he? His promise is that he will come again. A little later in chapter 3, look at verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises. Some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Brother Dave was talking about repentance. And I'll tell you what, we need a good dose of repentance, don't we? And so he said, here's why the Lord has not come. Because the Lord is long-suffering. He's still hoping one more person will come to Christ. He's not willing that any should perish. And so his promises are still in effect. His promise is just as true. His promise is just as accurate. His promise is just as important as it's ever been. But he's so patient, he wants every soul to come to Christ that can possibly come to Christ. And that's why he waits. And listen, what a time then for us to be busy. I believe we're living on the brink of Jesus coming. And so this evening, what I'd like to do, I want to talk about the promise of his coming. I want to talk about the plan of his coming. I want to talk about a prelude to it and then the preparation for it. And then tomorrow morning, if the Lord tarries till tomorrow morning, because you know there is a chance that he won't. I mean, it really is a chance. Yeah, I do too. You just don't want to put up with me speaking again tomorrow. But if I go to heaven, I'm not going to preach this message, okay? But I'm working on one. You see, the whole world sees Israel as a curse and how Israel's causing all the trouble. Do you know the Bible talks about how that Israel will be such a blessing that there will be a day when every person will hang on to a Jew. And I'm going to show how that is on the brink of coming. And that cannot take place until later in the whole time frame. So the promise of his coming, here it is. He said, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise. Do you think for 1 minute that God would make a promise and not fulfill it? Let me tell you this. If he did make a promise that he didn't fulfill, he's not God. But he does make promises. Matter of fact, over 8,000. Over 8,000 promises in the Bible. Can you name 10? Maybe that's why we don't rejoice in what a God we have. Because if you can't name his promises, they're no good at all. But his promises that he will come again. He's not slack concerning those promises. So what is the plan? What's the preparation for it? And so here's what I think it is. I really believe the next thing on God's prophetic calendar is Christ will come in the clouds. It's called the rapture. It's called the catching out. And I think that's the very next thing. Other things may occur, but there's not one single thing that must take place before Jesus comes back. Matter of fact, there's even some indicators that we're at the final end of the church age, that we're right next to when he will be here. And it says that the dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who are alive and remain. And so that's the promise, and that's the first part of the plan. And then the Bible says that the next thing will take place is there will be a treaty confirmed by an Antichrist. You see, the Antichrist cannot come until the church is gone. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. It says in Thessalonians that the Antichrist is there, But he will not be revealed. And the word reveal means to pull away the cover. It's like this. You might say, okay, where's the little clicker? And so when I pull away the cover, then the flipper, the clicker is revealed. But the flipper was there all along. And so the Bible says, after the church is gone, then the Antichrist will be revealed. The spirit of Antichrist is here already. I personally believe that the Antichrist is alive on planet Earth right now. I believe that some of the situations that have taken place in the last several months, including the proposed peace for Israel and the Middle East, indicate that an Antichrist must be here at this time. And so, before the tribulation begins, the Antichrist will make a treaty. Daniel 9:27 says this, he makes a treaty, he confirms the treaty, it's already made, he confirms. Now there's a lot of difference between confirming a treaty and making a treaty. Do you understand the difference? To make a treaty is one thing, but to confirm or to strengthen or to put it into effect is another. Some of you don't know the difference. Okay, the only way I know to do this is, I know you don't know this about me because I don't even know if I've ever told Ted, but do you know that I'm a champion apple pie baker? Why do you laugh? If it wasn't so late in the conference, I'd be slightly insulted. But I'm just going to give you my recipe. Take 2 quarts of apples, peel them, dice them into small chunks, 1/4 inch in size. Put 8 cups of sugar, mix. Put 2 sticks of butter. Put some flour in there. Mix until stir it until it's stiff. Put it into a pie shell. Put it in the oven at 600 degrees for 4 hours. Okay, I've never baked a pie in my life. Okay, could you tell that? Yeah. Okay, I can't cook anything. But if you bring me a piece of apple pie and put it there and I get a fork and I eat it, I can confirm that's a pie. But I can't make a pie, obviously, for my recipe. I know you cook it and I know you put apples in there. The rest of it, I have no idea. I couldn't make a pie if I had to, but I can sure confirm it. So when this guy comes on the scene, he confirms the treaty. The treaty's been made. Somewhere along the line, there's been an agreement, and it has no power. It can't get Israel to do what it wants. It can't get the Palestinians to do what it wants. It can't get the world to do what it wants. I'm going to show you there's 4 different people right now, tonight, vying for position in Jerusalem, in Israel, to bring about peace. Exactly as the Bible said would be in the last days. Folks, we cannot see a tribulation begin until the Antichrist confirms the treaty. The Antichrist cannot confirm the treaty until we're out of here because we restrict him. We hold him under that cover. And he says only when the church is gone, then will that Antichrist be revealed. Oh, he's been there, but he can't be revealed. And so we're on the brink of that taking place. And so that's part of his plan. There'll be 3.5 years. It's called the tribulation. Wow, during that time, 1/3 of all the earth is going to be scorched. 1/4 of all the men are going to die. Famine will come. Wars will come. Disasters will come. It's incredible. That's the good part of the tribulation. Because the very next part is called the Great Tribulation. That takes place when the Antichrist sets up an image to be worshipped. That takes place when right in the middle, at the end of 3.5 years, the devil himself, Satan himself, is kicked out of heaven. Boy, that'll be a relief to heaven when they do that house cleaning job. Because you know what he does in the meantime? It says he's the accuser of the brethren. He's up there. What a pain in the neck to have him there. And every time you do something wrong, he says, hey, Jesus, look at Lindstedt. And then Jesus says, hey, Heavenly Father, look at these. And the Father's reminded that Jesus died for me. Wow. And they're going to get sick of it. They're going to kick him out. And when he gets kicked out, he is so mad because now he knows his time is short. And so that will end with a great battle of Armageddon in which the Antichrist will be defeated. And then will begin a new heaven, or excuse me, the millennial kingdom, and then a new heaven and a new earth. God has an incredible plan. So he makes a promise. He says, listen, I'm going to come. Don't count me out. I've been long-suffering, but it doesn't mean I'm not going to fulfill it. And so there's his plan. Now let's look at some of the details of that plan. Because you see, John has taught us the appearance of the false triunity instead of the Trinity. And so let's go to Revelation chapter 12. And let's see how the plan of God is at work. In Revelation chapter 12, begin, if you will, down in verse 7, there was a war in heaven. Strange place to have a war, isn't it? Well, matter of fact, it's called Star Wars. Oh, this is the real one. George Walker just stole it from the Word of God. There was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast out unto the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So you can see that this is something incredible. According to Revelation chapter 12, this dragon, who corresponds to the devil, and I would say that in terms of a counterpart, it's like God the Father. Because you see, when you go to chapter 13, the first part, there's a beast. Notice this when you go to chapter 13. I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads, 10 horns, and upon his horn 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. Now, I personally think that the sea there is the Gentile world powers. So out of the Gentile world powers is going to come the first beast. And I believe that this beast is the Antichrist. And so he will come, and I think that just as the devil corresponds to God the Father, I think this beast, this Antichrist, he corresponds to God the Son. And then you come a little later into chapter 13 and go down to verse 11. I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. I believe the earth here represents the land of Israel. I believe that there will be a time when there will be a second beast, a false prophet. I think he will come out of the land of Israel. Will he be a Jew? I wouldn't be surprised. Do you know that there are some Jews who actually are so far away from Jehovah God that they could introduce an Antichrist? And it says that he corresponds to God the Holy Spirit. And to make the analogy complete, you see in Revelation 17, there's a harlot. There's a false church. And to me, it's interesting because, you see, there was a church in chapter 3 that was the Laodicean church, a church so cold, so far from God, you can't tell if it has life or not. It's a pretend church. It's a fake church. It's a false church. And when the real church is removed, that false church, it actually becomes the bride for this Antichrist. You see, everything that God has, the devil wants. And so if Jesus has a bride, then the Antichrist wants a bride. And Jesus wants a chaste virgin bride, Corinthians chapter 10. And the Antichrist, he wants a prostitute. Can you imagine having that for your bride? But the Bible describes her and talks about her actions and talks about her priorities. And so that's what the Bible predicts is coming. Now, let's examine this a little closer because you see in Revelation chapter 12, it's interesting because this great dragon, first thing it does, according to chapter 12, look in verse 1, it says that when this whole thing appears, a great wonder appears in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, upon her head, a crown of 12 stars. I think this woman is none other than Israel. Chapter 12, verse 3 says, a wonder appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on the heads. Now that's an important number. Before we're done, I hope you're going to understand that. There's going to be 7 horns and there's going to be 10 crowns. Now, I think that this whole description, excuse me, the 7 heads, I think there's going to be 7 kingdoms that support this Antichrist as he comes to power. I think it will have 10 horns, and the Bible says that those 10 horns are 10 kingdoms which have no power until the very end. And when they get their power, they're going to rule for 1 hour, for one little period of time, and they're going to give all their power to this Antichrist. Could that take place? Well, let's continue with our study and see if this makes sense. And so it says, first, there's this woman. By the way, do you know the Catholic Church actually thinks that they're the woman? I mean, this is unbelievable. Where does the 12 come in? Well, they say, well, that's the 12 apostles. My goodness, what an unusual interpretation of this. And so it says this, verse 4, that when this dragon, who's the devil, his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, cast him into the earth, the dragon's before the woman who was ready to be delivered to devour her child as soon as it was born. You see, I think the proper way to interpret that is that Satan wanted to destroy Jesus the minute he was born. Think about Herod. Remember how Herod was so aggravated when those wise men came to worship the baby. And so he ordered the execution of all the children. You know what? Satan has tried and tried and tried to stop the plan of God. And we can go all the way back to the book of Genesis. We can look at Cain and Abel. We can look at the flood. All those times, Satan's trying to pollute the human race. Satan is trying to destroy the plan of God. He can't do it. And so when Israel gives birth to the child, you know what? Satan tries to destroy the child. You want to know something? I believe that in 1948, when Israel became a nation, Satan was so displeased with that he tried to destroy Israel through Hitler. And I believe that in the coming day, once again, the Antichrist will try to destroy Israel. You want to know why? Because God promised that when these things are true of Israel, you'll know that I'm getting ready to set up my kingdom. Hey, he doesn't say you'll know the rapture's coming. Remember, we saw the millennium over here on this side of the chart, and it's coming for the saints, for the Christians on this side of the chart. He says, when you see Israel back in the land, when you see Israel doing, is that taking place? Nothing could be more important for us to understand tonight than the position of Israel. Tonight, people are cursing Israel. They're blasting Israel. There are churches you go into, and if they know you're a friend of Israel, they'll be very disappointed. I was on an airline in Europe. Somehow or another, it came up, where are you going? I said, well, I'm going to Israel to meet a group. And from that moment on, I didn't get so much as a cup of water from the stewardess. That's how bad she hated someone going to Israel. Now, the prejudice, the discrimination, the hatred for Israel is unbelievable. But the Bible says that's exactly how it would be. And so it says that Israel will have to hide. There will come a time when Israel had to hide in the wilderness. I personally believe it's going to be Petra. And it says that they're going to hide for 1,260 days, exactly that 3.5-year period. And then it says right in the middle of the tribulation, because you see, if you took 7 years, well, that would mean that it's two sets of 42 months. And each 42 months, multiplying it by 30 days, is 1,260 days. So for half of that time, Israel is under persecution. The point of the tribulation is for God to restore the Jew to seeing who Jesus Christ really is. It will cost them 2/3 of their population. Only 1/3 will respond. But God has an incredible plan for them. And so then Satan is kicked out. And when he does, he deceives the whole world. I personally think that that's where we come to Revelation chapter 13. Remember when he sets up the image of the beast? We're going to talk about that. And the reason I want to talk about that is because I think there's never been a time when the world would be easier to deceive than right now. What is taking place in technology, in our classrooms, in our governments right now would be the easiest time to receive. And then go with me to one other verse. And this one is in Revelation chapter 12. And verse 12, therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows that he hath but a short time. Wow, he's mad because when he gets kicked out of heaven, he knows he's only got 3.5 more years. Okay, let's move on. This Antichrist. Now, it's interesting because it says he comes out of the sea or out of the Gentile nations. I personally believe that the Bible also indicates that it will come at a time that's a revived Roman Empire. I'm going to pop ahead because when I show you this image, my guess is that you're real familiar with the story of Daniel. And so here's the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw. Remember, it started with a head of gold. And we know that that was Babylon because remember, Daniel said, "Thou, O king, art this head of gold." Remember that? And Neb, he says, "Wow, you know, I kind of think I look like gold. I just think of that myself." And then Daniel said, "Yeah, but you're going to be replaced with a kingdom of silver, and it's going to have two arms. It's going to be the Medes and the Persians. And then it would be by Alexander the Great and the Grecians." And then it talks about Rome would come to power, and then how Rome would fall. But Rome was replaced very different than all the other kingdoms. Because he said, Rome will come back, Rome will be revisited. And out of those iron legs, there will be toes, part of iron and part of clay. In other words, there will be these 10 kingdoms. Now, go back with me, because here's what it says in Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. And in the days of these kings, talking about the 10 toes, in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces, consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. So it says that when the time comes, politically, for the iron legs to rebirth into 10 toes, that's when the Lord will come to set up his kingdom. Are we together on that? And so if we could see the time when we're watching a revival of the Roman Empire, the ancient Roman Empire, and if we could see a time when that Roman Empire is now divided into 10 toes, we must be at a time very near when Christ is going to set up his kingdom, because Revelation says this, that when they come to power, they rule for 1 hour. Is that 60 ticks on the clock? Or is it just a brief period? I don't know. But it can't be very long. Are you with me? Shake your head this way. I know you don't say amen. Yeah. Okay, so here's what we're saying. We look at that image. I mean, we've been waiting hundreds of years for this. Daniel saw this. And Daniel said to Nebuchadnezzar, he said, listen. He said, the golden head's going to be replaced. The shoulders and arms of silver are going to be replaced. The brazen thighs are going to be replaced. The iron legs, that's the Roman Empire. We know that. And he says, then when you see it come back, part of iron, part of clay, something out of the old Roman Empire, something new mixed together, and there will be 10 regions, 10 kings. They will rule 1 hour. And they will give all their power to this Antichrist. And in the days of those kings, a kingdom will come represented by the stone. And he says, when that stone comes, that stone will rule forever. That's got to be the kingdom of God. Are you with me? And so that means that that's the millennium. And before the millennium, there's got to be a battle of Armageddon. And before the Armageddon, there's got to be 7 years of tribulation. Before the tribulation can ever start, there's got to be an Antichrist. Before the Antichrist can come, we got to get out of here. And then I watched the United Nations divide the world into 10 regions. I watched the World Bank speak of 10 economic regions. I say, wow, maybe we're just slow to understand. Maybe this is just an accident. Or maybe we're on the brink of Jesus coming. Now, let's go a little further. This Antichrist, his time frame, he's got 42 months. Now, I know you're familiar with that, and so we're covering some of this quick because this is the introduction to my message, and I've already promised Ted I will not go a minute past 9 o'clock. Yeah, all right? And so he's only got 42 months. So go with me to Revelation chapter 13. And it's interesting because here he is in Revelation chapter 13, and in 42 months, that's the first 3.5 years of this tribulation period. Okay? What does he do? He blasphemes God in believers. Next, he wants to set up something that's worldwide. We've already been talking about the globalization of the world, how that everything economically everything politically, everything socially, it's all coming together, isn't it? No one can deny the global aspects of it. He demands worship. And so in order to get the attention of all the world, he does one of the most incredible miracles. I like what's been said on miracles because you know something? Miracles can deceive people. I believe in miracles. The Bible speaks of miracles. But I don't believe that God is using miracles today to convince people of the reality of things because you know what? The miracles that I believe in are the resurrection of Jesus Christ and how God has worked in the past to bring Israel to its fruition. Exactly what the Bible predicted, not some of these wishy-washy things that are coming out. So what does this Antichrist do? He mocks, remember, everything that Jesus has, he wants. If God has Jerusalem, he's going to want Jerusalem. If Jesus has a bride, he wants a bride. If Jesus rose from the dead, guess what he wants to do? Yeah. So he's going to fake resurrection. Now, how do you fake resurrection? Well, here's how he does it. He has a counterpart. He has something that has equal power. It's a second beast. This beast, the first one, the Antichrist, he comes out of these 10 toes. Daniel speaks of the fact that in those 10 toes, a small one comes up. You know something? I think the Antichrist may be alive today, but he's not a household word. Don't ask me who it is. The Bible says we don't know. It would be a pure guess. It's ridiculous to guess. But I do think he's alive. I personally think that some of the meetings that have taken place in Europe, some of the meetings that are taking place in the last several weeks in Israel about how to divide the land, because that's going to be the first program of the Antichrist, I personally believe that the Antichrist is there. To accomplish his purpose, he has someone come out of the land. I think it's going to be out of the land of Israel. And then it says this, he's going to confirm the message of the Antichrist. He's going to have the same power. And so what he's going to do with the image of the beast, now that's it, not the beast, the image of the beast. Let's just go a step with this. And I got to go back. Now, this is an old clip. You're right.
Finally, from us this evening, technology on the cutting edge. We were interested today to hear that more than 100 law enforcement officials in Mexico are having microchips implanted in their arms. The chips allow a person to be scanned, sort of like a cereal box at the supermarket checkout. In Mexico, this will be one more tool in the fight against crime. Here's ABC's John McKenzie.
You've seen it before, right out of Hollywood.
It's maybe a little uncomfortable.
A microchip inside the body. A hidden high-tech identification tag.
They're the access codes to your job spot.
Now Mexico's attorney general and 160 of his deputies have had microchips implanted in their arms to control access to the country's new criminal investigation center. It is to provide access, said the attorney general, to the right people in exclusive areas where there is valuable, sensitive information. The microchip, the size of a grain of rice, is injected under the skin and gives off a low-frequency radio wave. A scanner reads each chip's identification number to verify an official's security clearance.
The microchip is tamper-proof, it's secure. No one can take your microchip and use it to their advantage to gain access to your facility.
The chip, developed by Applied Digital Solutions, is similar to those used in the U.S. to identify and return runaway dogs. In humans, it can have several uses.
Little stick.
The chips can also be programmed to carry medical information. The one in this patient details his blood type, allergies, and the fact he has Alzheimer's disease. The device is now awaiting approval from the Food and Drug Administration. Some researchers are developing microchips for use in the home so that wearing one can turn on lights and open doors. Hands-free. The next step, say researchers, is developing an implantable chip with a global positioning system to track people miles away, whether kidnapped or lost, just as cars can now be traced. A kind of LoJack for the body. John McKenzie, ABC News, New York.
That is our report on World News Tonight. I'm Peter Jennings. We hope you have a good evening.
Wow, think about that. Hey, you want to know something? I know it for a fact that in Israel, they can locate people to within 12 inches of where they're standing on planet Earth. I know for a fact that they can take a bomb and they can throw it into the window of a building. They can land it in a wastebasket in an office. I know for a fact that they can take something the size of a baseball and they can hit it. They can destroy it. Because that's how accurate these things are. Folks, we're just on the brink of having it compulsory. So when this Antichrist comes to power, and when he begins to say, you know, we've just had the disappearance of a lot of people. We've had some calamities. Look, we're having things that are scorching the earth. Look, we're having starvation. We've got to get things under control. You need to submit to my system. And so the minute you do that and you take his mark, then you essentially say, I vote for you. I elect you. You see, you're going to accept this Antichrist just the same way you accept Jesus Christ. And from that point on, your life is never going to be the same. Because you see, shortly after that, I believe that there's going to be an image. Now, I'm going to show you part of this. I'm going to interrupt it. But I want you to listen as you see the image coming on the screen, what she says. Oh, wow. We'll be back to that one. Oh, my. Here, I got to go. Okay, now listen to her. Almost There is the title.
Hello, and welcome to Almost There Entertainment. In the next 10 minutes, we're going to change your idea of what live entertainment can be.
Okay, stop
but
there
first,
just for a minute if we can.
Let me show you what we can do.
She's going to change your definition of what live entertainment can be. Here's my question. The images that you're going to look at, are they real or are they imaginary? Okay? Yeah, go ahead and stop there. Half of them were real, half of them were imaginary. I don't know if any of you have ever gone to Branson. Have you ever been to Branson? Now, I'm not trying to be anti-Branson, but there's a fiddle player there, Japanese fiddle player, and I can't pronounce his name, Fuji Miguji, or Faji Fafaji. I don't know, something like that. He is good. He's worth going to. And I mean, he fiddles, and then he fiddled behind him, and he fiddled under his leg, and he fiddled everywhere. But the thing that was most incredible was when he walked down those steps. And then when I looked, there were no steps at all. Yeah, it's all done with laser lights. He didn't walk down any, there's no steps there. I went to the engineer, I said, hey, how did you do? He said, that's over $1 million in laser lights. But he said, it puts the illusion of walking down steps. There's no steps. I went to Disney World. I sat on about the second row. The auditorium was empty. When they turned out the lights, all of a sudden, Abraham Lincoln, who was sitting up here, stood up, gave the Gettysburg Address. When they turned the lights back on, no one was there. I was 10 feet away. It was so real. Hey, you know what the Bible says? That when the Antichrist comes to power, he will give resurrection a new meaning. He will give life to the image of the beast. Do you understand that our kids are so into visual? I have a whole section of this where, I mean, you don't know what's real and what's not. And there's Michael Jackson. And if I showed you a real film of him dancing and I showed you the image, they have mimicked it absolutely perfect. All the gestures are there. That's how far we've come in technology. You know what the Bible said? That when the Antichrist comes to power, he will first say, I've got to control you. I've got to mark you. I'm doing this for your safety. This is the only way to make sure that you can have a job and you have food and you're going to be safe and you're going to be protected, because look at these catastrophes and we're going to believe it. Oh, I'm gone. Are you? Praise God if you are. And then he's going to give life to something that died. He's going to give life to the image of the beast. Listen, folks, we have the technology today to give life to those that are dead in an image form. And young people today are more hooked on that than they are anything else. Have you seen them? The only thing that works on their whole body are these two fingers. I mean, you can take away food. You can take away water. You can take away... They got to have their thumbs. They got to have their digital thing. Otherwise, they shake. Folks, we're there, aren't we? This doesn't come until the last half of the tribulation. You see, I really think that we're at exactly the place where we should be for Jesus to come, maybe tonight. Because the technology is already available to do exactly what the Bible said. I think we're really that close. Now, let's see. I want to go. Let's go to the next one. Look at this. Revelation 14, verse 11. It says this: the smoke of their torment ascended up forever and ever. They had no rest day or night, who worshiped the beast and his image, and who received the mark of his name. Do you understand how serious this is? Because I believe that when this Antichrist appears, he's going to be so convincing. He's going to be so deceptive. He's going to be so powerful that he will have people saying, wow, you know what? That has to be. Look, he brought someone dead. There they are. Look at the miracles. Look at the promises he's making. They're going to be desperate to trust him. And I believe that he will capture the minds, the lives of people. And once they receive that mark, after that point, they will never be able to recant on that. I fear for those that are left behind. You see, there's only one way to make sure that you're not in that group, and that's to receive Jesus Christ today. Be ready, because I think the Lord could come. I don't have it on the here, and I wish I did, but there was an incredible thing. You can get it on YouTube, and it's a cat, all right? They take a bell, they put it under three cups, and they move it around. And you try to get, have any of you seen this? Oh, it's fantastic. And I mean, they move that thing around just like crazy. And you try to pick out the right one, and you're going to be one out of three. But this cat is 100%. I mean, it's incredible. You know what it proves? It proves that the hand's quicker than the eye. You see, when we look at an image, we don't really see what's going on. We can be tricked. Now, I'd like to have a kitten from that cat. I mean, that thing, it was fantastic. But you see, today, kids believe what they see visually. They don't believe what their mind tells them. They are so hooked into the visual that when the Antichrist comes, he will come visually, digitally. He's going to be a tech guy. And they are going to swallow it hook, line, and sinker. We're perfectly set up for it, aren't we? Do you see how we're living in the days exactly as the Bible said? Then let's go one step further. I'm trying to do a summary. Do I have 15 minutes? Or no, don't tell me that. Okay, look at this. the false church versus the true church. Now go with me to Revelation 17, because I'm hoping that we can do a summary. That's why I'm trying not to take a lot of time on each one of these, because I have yet another point that I think is important. But Revelation 17, verse 1. And there came one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls and talked with me, saying to me, come here, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot that sits upon many waters. Now what does it mean when it says that she sits on many waters? Well, go all the way down to verse 15. And he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the harlot sit are peoples, multitudes, nations, tongues. In other words, this is a worldwide church. It's a false church. Now, why do they call her a prostitute? Well, a prostitute is someone who sells herself for gain, maybe for money. But according to chapter 17, verses 2 and 3, it says that she's committed fornication with the inhabitants of the earth. With the political powers, she sells herself. Look at the church today. Do you understand? The church today wants political power. They don't want power from the Spirit of God. They don't want to win souls. They want political power. And we've traded the political power for the power to win souls. And so she sells herself for political power. She's worldwide. Next, it says that she sits. You'll find her position in verse 1, sitting. You'll find her position in verse 3, verse 9, she's always sitting. I just want to show you a couple things. I got many other examples, but for the sake of time tonight, here is the European magazine, and it shows a picture of the revived Roman Empire, and it shows a woman on a beast. Their own symbol for the European Union is a woman on a beast. That's an accident. But if it is, why is their coin, the European coin, why is it the woman on the beast? And if that's an accident, why is their second stamp a woman on the beast with the subtitle begging to be worshipped? You see, I don't think it is an accident. I think we're being introduced to the whole situation of this revived Roman Empire. And then it says that when she comes to power, it will be at the time of the seventh heads and when there's 10 horns. It says that she's the mother of harlots, all the false religions who have come out of her. You see, back in Babylon, that was the beginning of this false religious system. And you go to the book of Zechariah chapter 5, and you'll find here was a woman, and she carries our storks, and they're carrying a basket, and under a lead weight, there's a woman, and she pops out. And it says at the end time, she comes back to her original base. There it is. She's the mother of many false religions. They all come back. All the religions of the world will come back and support this Antichrist. Listen, he will be a religious character. He'll be high tech. He'll be religious. He will be such an incredible speaker, such an incredible politician. He'll be a master at economics. He will be able to solve all the problems, and the people will believe it. Want to know why? The Spirit of God has exited the scene. The church of God is gone. It will be a time of disaster. And people after people who refuse the message of Jesus now will fall for the lie. Remember, Jesus has the truth and the devil has the lie. But his lie is so convincing, so powerful, it's so deceptive. They'll say, I see it with my eyes. It's got to be true. Listen, folks, you can sit in the room. You say, there's Abraham Lincoln, down to the hair of his whisker. And there's no Lincoln at all. Just a deception. We're set up for that, aren't we? The woman, well, she's on seven hills. It describes her. It says that she's bedecked with red and scarlet. She has gold. It says she's drunk with the blood of the saints that she's killed. Well, I'm going to get real ugly here for a minute. Did you watch as the new pope was put into power? What was the color that dominated your television screen? Scarlet. Did you hear him talk about the wealth? The Catholic Church has more wealth than the top five corporations of the United States combined. Don't feel sorry one second for them economically. And have they ever been responsible for the death of Christians? My friend, you go back and you check history. The description of the false church, we know whoever it is. And it's interesting because this false church, I think it goes way bigger. I think it's worldwide. I think it's going to bring in the Hindus, the Buddhists. I think it's going to bring in the New Age. I think Chrislam will be a whole part of that. Listen, folks, we've never been at a time when religion has offered to compromise more to bring people together than right now. What a time for an Antichrist to come. What a time to bring all the religions together. And the Antichrist is going to say, you know what? After he gets all those powers, he's going to say, I don't need you. He's going to destroy her. She's not a permanent part of his plan. Here's the sign that's so important. Israel regathered. You know, the Bible says that if you see all this taking place, then you've got to see, is Israel being regathered? Is Israel going back to the land? Oh, my goodness. Maybe we are living in the last days. Matter of fact, the Bible says you'll know the regathering's for real when it says this, fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east. I will gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up. To the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from afar, my daughters from the ends of the earth. Is that true? When Israel became a nation in 1948, the first people that came back were people from China, Jews in China. It's just an accident, said out of the east. And the next one that came back, well, they were out of Europe. They were out of the west. And the next that came back, well, they were the Russian Jews out of the north. And I was sitting at breakfast with Colonel Yehuda Levy. And I said, do you really think that Israel's repopulation is exactly what the Bible says? He says, I'm positive. And he went through this verse place by place by place. And he pointed to the paper of the morning. And he said, look, here are the Phoenicia Jews coming out of Ethiopia from the south. Folks, for hundreds of years, God has been waiting for that. And we're the ones that are watching it take place. Are we living in the last days? The Bible says you'll know because it says that Amos 9:14, that cities will be rebuilt. They'll be inhabited. They'll plant vineyards. It says that Isaiah 27, that Israel will blossom and bud and fill the face of the earth with fruit. If you've heard me speak, I always work this article in. Saturday Evening Post, not a Christian publication. They talk about a farmer. And this farmer, using salt water, waters crops in the desert, and he gets a record production. Matter of fact, he's growing, up here it says he's growing 3 to 4 crops a year. He's growing 20 to 30 times any other production in all the area. He's making the desert bloom. What did the Bible say would be in the last days? Hey, that's not a sign for the rapture. That's a sign for the kingdom of God. And before the kingdom of God, there's going to be Armageddon. And before Armageddon, 7 years of tribulation. And before that, an Antichrist will come on the scene to deceive people. Hey, folks, do you see how far down the line we are? Hey, look at this. December the 30th, 2012, Israel feeds the world. In recent years, Israel expertise has been heavily in demand in India, Africa, China. Tomorrow, I'm going to show you a clip. If you're here, I'm going to show you a clip that's unbelievable. It's produced by the nation of Israel, not to show Jesus is coming soon, but I promise you, he'll have 10 or 11 or 12 points that are exactly what the Bible says. A PhD from Harvard trying to convince people to go back to Israel that are Jews. I'll show you, it's going to tell you how near we are to the coming of Christ. In the desert, 150,000 tons of peppers in just one single year. Or how about this one? February the 14th, Valentine's Day. Do you know that Israel sells more flowers than Holland? Yeah, little Israel in the desert. The Bible says, hey, you're going to know. When you see the people of Israel gathered back in the land, you know I'm on the brink of coming. When you see Israel growing crops in the desert, you know I'm on the brink of coming. When you see Israel filling the whole world with their fruit, you know I'm coming. Hey, the plowman overtakes the reaper. The Bible says you're going to know because when the plowman overtakes the man harvesting, you know I'm on the brink of coming. How can that happen? I was in Israel. I was on a farm, and there was a farmer, and he was planting crop number 7. 7 crops in 1 year from one piece of ground, and before he harvested crop 6, he was putting in number 7. The plowman overtook the reaper, exactly as the Bible said hundreds of years ago for the last days. Folks, you know what? Either we're making this up, or you and I are on the brink of Jesus coming. Oh, wow, the birds. This is off an official Israeli site. Look at this. 500 million birds. You know what they do? Every year, twice a year, they fly right through this thing as they go from Asia and Europe down to Africa, and they fly right to a place called Megiddo Valley. Just an accident, if you believe in accidents. And the Bible says that he will bring the birds there to the valley to clean the bones of the kings that come there to fight. I asked my guide. His name is Paul. I call him Saul. He's not a believer. And I looked up and I saw some buzzards there and I said, hey, I said, look at this little track. I showed him a track and it talked about how the buzzards are laying 2 and 3 eggs. And he says, that's exactly what I could picture you Christians believing. He said, buzzards only lay 1 egg. Yeah, okay. About 3 months later, I was in Israel. And the sky was black with birds. He said, hey, do you remember when you showed me that little track? I said, yeah, I won't forget that. He says, well, I was right and you were right. I said, how could that be? He said, well, I was right. Buzzards only lay 1 egg. He said, you are right. We don't understand how or why, but all the buzzards are flying right down Megiddo Valley so much that the only military airport in Israel's whole country is in Megiddo Valley, and we can't even take our planes off. There's so many buzzards. Hey, folks, I know why. The Bible says that at the end, that the buzzards will come and they'll clean, they'll pick the bones and the flesh from mighty men, from captains. Listen, folks, the birds are already there. They're waiting for this whole battle to take place. The Bible says that cities will be rebuilt. Look at those cities. Every one of those have been destroyed and rebuilt exactly as the Bible said. There's not one city the Bible said would be rebuilt that's not rebuilt at this hour. Another accident? Oh, or how about this one? The Bible says you'll know in the last days because Israel will be a great army. Are they a great army? They're a legend. Or maybe this one. The Bible says, hey, you'll know, Ezekiel 37, it says you'll know because Israel will no longer be 2 sticks, they'll be 1. Huh. I'll never forget this lesson. Mr. Rabin, Yitzhak Rabin, I had the privilege of being his host when he was in America. We talked about a number of things. I remember talking to him one night just before he went up to speak in one of the temples there in my home city. And I said, when do you think the Messiah is coming? He said, tomorrow. I said, well, then what do you do with Ezekiel chapter 38? He says, you mean when Russia invades Israel? I said, yes, sir. He says, well, we know they're coming. We'll be prepared. I said, well, wait a minute. When's that going to happen? He says, that may happen tonight. I said, so the millennial kingdom is tomorrow, and Russia may come tonight. I said, yeah, but how do you know? How do you know that Israel's being regathered for the last time? He said, oh, that's simple. He said, the prophet said, when the 2 sticks become 1, then you'll know it's the final regathering. Do you know how that took place? You see, Judah and Israel, from the time that they were destroyed in 70 AD, they were Judah and Israel. But in 1948, when they came back, they said, we'll no longer come back as 2 nations. We won't come back as Judah and Israel. We'll come back as 1 united Israel. Exactly as the Bible said, folks. We're not going to be regathered and shoved out and regathered. It's everything is set up. Do you understand how close we are? The Bible says that in the last days, they'll go for sacrifices. All the instruments are made. They're looking for the red. This is Time magazine talking about the red heifer. Don't you like when Time talks about the Bible things like the red heifer? Oh, they might be looking for the heifer. I'm looking for Jesus. That didn't have to happen until the tribulation. I think they will begin to sacrifice. I think they will cremate a red heifer or find the ashes. That's okay. I'm just saying, everyone's looking for it. Do you know that recently, in spite of what the Arabs say, that there's not a single stone or a single thing that shows that there was ever Jewish occupation, they just found a bell, a golden bell, that was used on the priest's garments. That wasn't on some Islamic priest. That was on a Jewish priest. They found a medallion that has a menorah. That menorah is not an Islamic sign. That's a Jewish sign. All that's been found to prove. You know what they say? They say, we believe that's a sign from God to build the temple without delay. Hey, folks, I don't have to have a temple. I'm looking for Jesus. I'm not looking for a temple. You see how the Bible talks about oil. Oh, my goodness. February 1st. I hate to quote something 60 days old, but there we are. Do you know what's changing? I mean, wow, that's another whole message. Oh, my goodness. Here we go. So what's next? A desire to control Jerusalem. Let me show you how politically this is going. See, Jerusalem came into being November 29, 1947. The General Assembly of the United Nations passed a resolution. Resolution 181, if you want to look it up. It said this, that really the United Nations has control over Jerusalem. They called it a corpus separatum, a body of separate covenant. And so that's why the United Nations says, we control Jerusalem. Now, that wouldn't be so bad, but do you know that Islam says they control the Temple Mount? Here's the proof. Right now, Jews cannot go up there and have any service. When I go up there, they will ask, do you have a Bible, a New Testament? You're not allowed to go up there with a Bible. They say it's a controversial book. It could start a revolution. I don't know what the Quran is. Okay? So the Palestinians warn Obama not to visit Judaism's holy temple unless by Muslim rules. I mean, this is in the middle of Jerusalem on the Temple Mount where the temple stood, and they want Obama to go by Muslim rules. He did. Oh, believe me, he did. Yeah, he practiced his own religion up there. And they told him not to bring any Israeli officials. So here is Islam. They want to control the Temple Mount. Look at this one. This is February the 1st, 2013. Israel sold Jerusalem to the Vatican. And one of the most incredible things, the Vatican now has permission for the Pope to come to what's called the upper room and to have his mass and to have his special ceremonies in the upper room in Jerusalem. Unbelievable. Everybody wants control of it. The Antichrist, you know, his biggest desire is to have Jerusalem. Want to know why? God says, that's my city. That's where my name is engraved. It's mine forever. You see, whatever Jesus has, the devil wants. Folks, do you understand why there's going to be such turmoil for Jerusalem? Do you understand why all the nations are looking at Jerusalem? Why it's such a boiling point? So Obama goes. He said, I want my second term to be marked with peace in the Middle East. Yeah, absolutely unbelievable. And so what he did to bring about that peace, he said, it has to do with ownership. And that's why I showed you that little clip where the White House completely cleansed their website. They no longer refer to Jerusalem as being Jewish. They say, they don't even say it's in Israel. They want it to be in the West Bank. So that when they give it away, it won't be a big deal. It's incredible because remember that poor guy as he tried to answer the reporter and said, okay, what is the capital of Jerusalem? He says, well, you know what it is. No, tell us. Well, it hasn't changed. It has changed. There's not one time that Israel said the capital was Tel Aviv. But he couldn't get Jerusalem to come out of his mouth, could he? He couldn't say Tel Aviv. Folks, do you understand? The Bible says that in the last days the conflict would be for Jerusalem. All the armies of the world would come against Jerusalem. We're watching it, aren't we? These are the big ones. And so the new Secretary of State, anti-Israel. The new Secretary of Defense, wow, did you see what he said about Israel? He's not even sure that Israel should defend itself if attacked by Iran. That's the Minister of Defense. Oh, listen, folks. We could not be set up better for an Antichrist than right now. But there's one thing that holds him back. Oh, the enemies. Oh, I got to show you this one. Yeah. The Bible says, you know, in the last days, because Syria is going to be wiped out. There's going to be trouble in Syria. There's going to be so much trouble that Syria is going to be destroyed. Damascus will be destroyed, it said. I mean, that couldn't happen, could it? Oh, wait a minute. 90,000 people have already died there. And there's a threat of chemical warfare right now. I mean, tonight. That's what's going on. Well, the United States sent 20 more F-16s to Cairo. This is unbelievable. $1 billion in foreign aid to a country that wants to destroy America. I mean, their own words, they want to destroy us, and we gave them $1 billion. We deserve to be destroyed. I don't know about you guys. I may be moving up here sooner than you think. The search, listen, you know what? Hey, the Bible says when they say peace and safety, there will be sudden destruction. Have you heard him say it? We want to bring about peace and safety. Listen, that's going to be the message of the Antichrist. Put a device, peace and safety. Trust me. I can resurrect the dead. I can do miracles. I can deliver you. I can give you whatever you promise. Listen, folks, I believe that Satan always is looking for a man to be ready to step in. And I believe that when the church is gone, Satan will pick his man, and that man will begin the devilish work of deception for the whole earth. Wow. There's more to say. Our time is gone. Thank you for your patience. So how do we live? No. Yeah, good. I'm glad you didn't, because I'm over. How do we live? You know what it is? We're either going to be a cork or a conduit. We're either going to go out of here and have fear, or we're going to have rejoicing that Jesus is coming again, and he's going to give us one more day, one more hour, one more person to talk to tell them about Jesus Christ. Thank you for coming. God bless you.